It worked. Now, what's this?
The housekeeper buried something in the flower patch beneath one of Dr. Gray's windows. She was singing in some Creole language, performing a peculiar bourgeois voodoo ritual. Certainly not an unfamiliar sight in the French Quarter, but voodoo had never felt this bitter to Emily.
What's that? It's another piece of broken plate. There we go. This must be the clock mentioned in the... This looks like the thing that held the talisman in the French Quarter. It's broken and missing some pieces. What a strange but beautiful room. There's some aggressive-looking rot on these paintings. The Astarte Artist Colony. I'm pretty sure they had a Mardi Gras crew called the Pirates of Pontchartrain when I was a child. To remember how to get them out again. They are locked up for good reason. I am sure she is still able to whisper the answer in the ears of the wrong people. But not for long. I will see her burned soon enough. That black goat will be sacrificed to put an end to it all. Then it will all be over. No more Derceto, and sadly, no Astarte. Those good pirates of Pontchartrain. May you still sail the lake until you find the shores of Hali. Are these zodiac signs? I've seen this somewhere. Did it break? The clock just... me something. That's just the hallway outside Jeremy's room, isn't it? Jeremy's room. All back to normal.
Emily's here!
Emily deserved a sense of triumph, but she was too on edge to appreciate her success. There was no reasonable explanation why the talisman let her open up this other world. Was this really happening, or was this somehow all in her mind? There was no time to question her own sanity. She had to find Jeremy. If he was here, she thought, would she find Jeremy in the hateful mound?
I did it. I opened up another dream.
May 1923, Monday. All okay, ready for delivery. Maintenance, oil pump must be serviced. Any tampering causes large spills unless properly forestalled. Tuesday, shipment delayed but delivered. Maintenance, service bridge close to broken. Wednesday, prospectors reluctantly agreed to show the burial mound to Mr. Hartwood, a painter, who read about our finds in the papers. He means to return tomorrow and try to find a way inside. Thursday. Mr. Hartwood's efforts delayed. Workers seemed nervous about his presence. Hartwood promised not to return to the compound. Instead, he has taken up an offer by L'Officier, the riverboat captain, who means to pilot him to the site tomorrow morning. Hopefully, that's the end. Work can resume. Maintenance. Bridge from the oil tower to the bayou has collapsed. Sabotage suspected.
This is the devil that guides us now.
Huh. I need the key. There's something missing. There's something missing. Just don't look down, Emily. Hateful Mount Jeremy mentioned in his book. Jeremy, you dropped your...
Mrs. Marcus?
Get off of me!
What are you doing here?
Trying to find my uncle.
Jeremy is your uncle?
Could you please? Thank you. And it's Miss Hartwood.
You don't remember me?
I remember you, Mr. Bois. I met your brother, Baptiste, earlier.
I suppose he hadn't found Jeremy either then. We spread out to find him.
Can I have this? I'm trying to get to Tarawea.
Fine, believe the rest. I just want Jeremy to come looking. We have to leave before it comes inside.
What? Where?
Come quick!
Oh, God damn my soul.
The dream of the grave. The dream of the grave under the chenier suddenly vanished, and Emily found herself back at Derceto. Instead of Jeremy, she found Lottie, who, just like her brother Baptiste, reminded her of John, who died so bravely in the war. She pushed her painful memories out of her mind and returned to her investigation. She still needed to figure out what to do with the boiler.
I'm back at Derceto.
Reflections on the Power of the Verb in Certain Texts by Juan Luis Jorge. To act is in itself divine. Even the slightest movement of our hand is evidence of our soul in motion. Yet our free will is so easily overwhelmed by the dullness of everyday life. Our actions become rote and rigid, in spite of luxury and comfort. True divinity is found in the choice of leaving the stage where we all perform. People who discover this freedom unexpectedly will be struck by the terror of this revelation and become paralyzed, or worse, turn to suicide. However, if you are able to weather that storm, you will discover that there is a divine path beyond that fear. There is a chance to dismount your destiny and make something new. Something that hasn't been planned for or predestined. There is difficulty in explaining this type of acting as it transcends our everyday choices. This isn't some banal decision choosing one career over the other, or even who I should marry. Leaving the stage, no matter how, isn't a matter of course correction. It's a rejection of the story that the creator is telling.
It's wet shut. It worked.
The Barlow lens. Instructions. To double the magnification of your telescope, simply fit this Barlow lens to your instrument. Then operate the fine tuners to adjust the distance between your lenses. This is easily done while looking through your eyepiece. Simply search for a position where your picture is clear and appears flat. When correctly tuned, your telescope should present a clear picture with magnificent magnification.
This. I don't have everything I need. Now this'll come in handy. Locked. Okay, that wasn't so bad. Guess this works too. Jeremy? What the hell is that? What? There was a dead body in here. Did I just imagine that?
Mr. Waits, I saw a piece of the plate that Liza broke. I think she's been hiding them. She's not very good at it. She just chucked it into the little room with all the tools behind the boiler. I left it there. I didn't want to embarrass her by picking it up while she was looking. We went upstairs instead and played backgammon. I let her win, because she's so unhappy. The piece looked like the one on display in Cassandra's room. You know about that one already, right? Or is your eyesight really that fuzzy? I hope you don't feel bad about your glasses. You only look stupid when you squint. Maybe if you had more eyes, you would see these things. I wish you had all the eyes you needed. Your best and favorite guest, Grace.
The body of Derceto's clerk, transformed into some eye-clad abomination before he suddenly disappeared. Surely it was all in her head, a horrible vision planted by the dark man.
Thank you.
wet shut. It worked. What's that stain? Looks like some kind of rot.
Come on, Grace. I'm too tired for games. I'll even let you play with my jackknife. Oh, good evening. You haven't seen a little girl by any chance, have you?
I don't think so.
You would have known if you did. Kid crazy enough to be in this place.
She's not in her room, then?
That would be a first. Always running around causing trouble. She's very hard to pin down, that one. You want a sip?
I'm good, thank you.
Well, I should be going then. Unless there's anything you need from me.
I just want to find my uncle before anything happens to him.
Oh, don't worry, miss. He'll show up. He is much too lily-livered to kill himself.
Why would he?
It's his greatest ambition, didn't you know? Take care now.
McCarthy moseyed off to continue his search for the little girl. Emily had meant to ask why he was looking for her, but decided against it, fearing that it would just prolong an already awkward scene.
There's something missing. So this is Grace's room. Cute.
Don't you worry, Grace. Go play your game, bleat and bellow with the others. I won't be jealous. There will be more masquerades. However, I would love it if you would finish my mask for the feast. With love, Ruth.
Thank you. This must be the great Cassandra Beauregard's room. I'm not sure what I expected. Maybe something more extravagant? What's that? I need something else. I'm not sure I have everything I need. I think I've seen this somewhere.
Miss Beauregard, I picked up your medicine at the post office today. As you understand, it needs to be administered by the orderlies for your safety. I have put the box in Lottie's room for now, and I'm sure she will find you as soon as possible. Mr. Waits.
I'm not sure I have everything I need. I need the key.
Do you teach piano as well?
Huh?
You're a governess. Did you teach those clawing Casino kids how to play the piano?
How do you know about that?
Just because grown-ups don't notice children doesn't mean we don't notice you.
Yes. I taught them some piano.
Are you any good at it?
Not good enough to play a broken one.
It fell from the attic. Brought half the ceiling down.
It was Jeremy's fault, wasn't it?
Nobody knows what happened, but you're not wrong.
are you doing?
I'm gonna go now. See you around.
The prick of the syringe hadn't hurt as much as the humiliation of being played by that child. Emily just couldn't make any sense of her behavior. Grace seemed amused, but not mocking. Was this just her being playful? As her feelings subsided, a second thought appeared. She wouldn't have injected her with something, would she?
As the world moved into the new decade, America was spiraling into a maelstrom of debt, drought, and death. It was called the Great Depression and ruined many families. It was a fitting name, for poverty also breeds madness through desperation. Jeremy was, of course, no such victim, for he already witnessed the darkness within. He knew the shadow that stood on his threshold very well. It wasn't new. It was something that had always been with him.
Ugh. There's more of that unsettling rot.
On the commonplace of evil, there lies virtue and stark irreverence, careless thoughts of luminous indifference. But blame not the beast we once were, which science so often wished to refer. Not the wicked full of sin. It is you who stand and grin. All our good intentions aside, whereupon we build our pride. Sunless solitude, follow not this corrupting light. Prophets of confidence always crashes out of sight. Hear me, for we all bear this mark. Thus we must remain alone in the dark.
Let's write this down. I need the key. Talisman is showing another room. Something is opened. Worked. I'm in another one of Jeremy's dreams.
Emily stepped out into the humid night and found herself recognizing the Lafayette Cemetery. She hadn't been here for years, she thought, and in a way, she still hadn't returned. This was something not quite the same. Hoping she would soon get to see her uncle, she set off to find the chapel mentioned in his book.
It's been a while since I visited the family tomb. I hope it's in a better state than the real world. This. What's that for? There we go.
It was the chapel where Jeremy had promised to mourn the mysterious Perosi. Maybe soon she would be able to talk to her uncle and have him end this madness. She just needed to find a way inside the chapel.
This is the chapel in Jeremy's book. It looks like I need more medallions to open it. I'm not sure I have everything I need.